Alliance is an interagency network of over 100 organizations, and our work centers around supporting field practitioners in terms of technical guidance and tools and standards. Many of you, I'm sure, are familiar with the Minimum Standards for Child Protection and Humanitarian Action, which is our flagship document. We also have many other documents that provide more in-depth technical guidance, collecting lessons learned from the field and best practices and the latest evidence to support people like many of you who are on this call, who are providing direct service to children who require protection support. I mentioned that this webinar is focused on refugee context. Of course, UNHCR's mandate goes beyond just refugees. The protection cluster, for example, focuses on cluster that sits under UNHCR, focuses on cluster settings. But this particular webinar is specifically focused on refugees and not necessarily cluster settings. I will invite Bernadette to help us start the webinar. Mrs. Bernadette Castel-Hollingsworth studied international law at the University of Aix-Marseille Trois and Paris Aix-Nantes, where she earned a master's degree in international humanitarian action, emergency and rehabilitation, human rights, and civil rights. Bernadette joined the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, or UNHCR, in 2000, and has held numerous positions in protection and management in Pakistan, Liberia, Uganda, Sri Lanka, Tanzania, and many other countries. From November 2017 to 2018, Ms. Castel-Hollingsworth was Senior Protection Coordinator in Cox's Bazar in Bangladesh, after which she was deployed on emergency support missions to Burkina Faso and Cameroon. Since May 2019, Bernadette has joined UNHCR's headquarters in Geneva, where she's the Deputy Director of the Division of International Protection, Field Protection Service. Ms. Castel-Hollingsworth is married with two children, so you must have your hands full with homeschooling and all of that. Over to you, Bernadette.
Thank you very much, Hani, and thank you to all members of the Alliance Network. Good afternoon, good morning, and good evening to you all, colleagues around the world. My presentation will be divided into three parties. I will first talk to the changes that we have seen in the protection environment in general for refugees around the world over the past few weeks. We'll then go into more COVID-19 specific protection risks and concerns that we have seen emerging. And finally, I'll be happy to share with you some of our key protection messages and also strategic directions. The virus does not discriminate. Many refugees are at heightened risks. And the reason for that is that 3/4 of refugees around the world live in camp settings, often overcrowded, or they live in makeshift shelters in undeserved urban areas. Many refugees and asylum seekers do not yet have access to health, sanitation, or water. And in many of the places where they live, social distancing is simply very difficult or sometimes not possible. It makes them more at risk and more vulnerable than many of us. As we speak today, there are government-imposed restrictions to prevent or contain COVID-19 almost everywhere in the world. We have seen as part of these measures, and we estimate as of today that there are some 120 countries that have fully or partially closed their borders. And that includes 30 countries who are making no exception to admit on their territory asylum seekers. And the government-imposed restrictions have resulted in serious disruptions in access to life-saving assistance and services, as well as to income-generating activities. Now, these disruptions disproportionately affect asylum seekers, refugees, and other forcibly displaced people because often these populations rely on these life-saving assistance and services that they would otherwise not have access to. the movement restrictions that we see in all countries that have, for instance, taken confinement measures, restrict access of asylum seekers and refugees to services, but also our access to them. As part of the restrictions, an effect of them is a crucial one, which is the face-to-face protection activities that we had until a few weeks ago in all of our activities and that are now severely constrained. And this is, of course, UNHCR protection activities, but also that of all our partners. Today, the majority of protection, child protection, GBV colleagues, the refugee status determination officers are working remotely. And it means that they are no longer able to have this face-to-face, very important interaction. In a number of regions, we have also, as a result of COVID-19, seen and the suspension of voluntary repatriation programs, in particular in Africa, but also all resettlement departures, except for emergency cases, have been suspended. And then I think it's very important to remember and highlight that actually COVID-19 is a crisis within the crisis. It's an emergency on top of other emergencies in many parts of the world. There are ongoing conflicts, despite the call of the Secretary General last week to have ceasefires. These are not respected. We are very concerned for the situation in Yemen, in Libya, in Syria, in the Sahel, in the Lake Chad Basin, but also in Afghanistan, in South Sudan, in Venezuela, in Central America. I cannot cite them all, but these are ongoing conflicts that continue and that will have devastating effects on the populations when COVID 19 will reach some of the remote populations in these remote areas. I need to now also say that we have seen positive trends, states taking measures that are commendable, that are expected as well. We see that many countries have included and stated that refugees and asylum seekers would be part of their national response to COVID. We have seen many countries also extending, for example, for extended periods of time, the validity of asylum seeker and refugee documents or their authorization to stay in country. We have also seen a number of countries who decided to continue to receive asylum seekers and to allow that despite border closures they have put in place, quarantine, for example. So these are very good trends that we hope will continue to generalize. What are the protection risks and concerns? And my colleagues speaking after me will of course come back in more details into the child protection specific concerns, but we think it's important to also highlight what are the concerns for the refugee communities at large. First and foremost, despite COVID and because there are still active conflicts and persecution is continuing, refugees continue to flee their own country, and we need to ensure that they have access to international protection. It means that we need to ensure that they are not at risk of refoulement. Also, that we are noticing, for instance, there are returns under adverse conditions in Africa and in the Americas taking place. This is not only refugees, also displaced persons are returning sometimes to unsafe situations, or they are being returned. As you know, xenophobia, stigma, scapegoating, and targeted attacks have been reported all over the world, in particular against foreigners, but also vulnerable and marginalized persons, including in some instances, refugees and asylum seekers. In many cases, this is due to misinformation about COVID, and we'll come back to the importance of communication, not only with refugees and asylum seekers, but also with their host communities. We have concerns and monitored and reported concerns that all over the world, in all regions, some asylum seekers and refugees, particularly those that are not documented, are not coming forward for testing and treatment for fear of being deported. So it's a big issue. We are, of course, like all of you I know, very concerned about rise in gender-based violence, domestic violence in particular, but not only, and child abuse. This is, of course, as a result of containment, loss of income, rising tensions within the households, the fact that the children can no longer go to school, that their traditional or usual activities are no longer there. Amanda will be talking to that. In particular, I mean, states themselves have made statements on gender-based violence. I can think, for example, of what I've seen recently in the US, the UK, France. It is happening everywhere. We are very concerned that evictions of persons of concern to UNHCR have started, and we are even more worried that actually this trend will continue because of the economic consequences of the pandemic. So this is something to look out for, to monitor and to address, because the loss of dwelling has an impact on the protection of entire families and communities. My colleague Pieter will talk about the psychosocial needs of refugees and asylum seekers at this point in time. And like gender-based violence and like child abuse, psychosocial needs are only increased with the COVID-19 pandemic. They were there already. These needs not always fully addressed, and more will need to be done to try to assist the most vulnerable populations in this regard. And then finally, we cannot talk about protection risks and concerns without already anticipating what the long-term socioeconomic impacts of the pandemic will be. UNHCR is looking at this already, not only the impact on us as communities and refugee communities and host communities, but also from the perspective of the future of aid and what it will mean, what recession may mean as well in terms of services to the most vulnerable populations. The key messages and strategies that we have been working on the 30th of March, the High Commissioner has shared 5 key messages on protection of refugees. These messages are: one, states can and should ensure access to asylum seekers while also protecting public health. It is possible. Some states have, as I said before, put in place health screening or quarantine measures that continue a certain level of access of asylum seekers to territory. The reception of asylum seekers and the processing of their asylum claims should also continue. It's important because in many countries without documentation, you may not be able to access services for yourself or your children. And without asylum claims being processed, there is no documentation. So this is really a priority, in particular for the most vulnerable individuals within communities. We have advised member states on the use of technology, how interviewing can be done remotely with translation as well. And we see already some good practices in some regions. The third message from the High Commissioner is a reminder again that restrictions on freedom of movement may be justified and may be legitimate for public health reasons, but they must at the same time meet international standards. They cannot justify immigration detention. The fourth important message is to remember that restrictions on rights should not be maintained beyond for no longer than necessary. They must be temporary, and together with all of you and other UN and civil society partners, this is something we will be monitoring. And then the fifth important message that you have heard UNHCR talk about, including through the Global Compact for Refugees and at the Global Refugee Forum in December last year, is the importance of inclusion of refugees and asylum seekers in national systems and services. And here in the context of the pandemic, we are advocating very strongly and hope to have your support as well to advocate for equal access to national health services. It's important because it is the only way we will be able to fight the virus effectively is if the national health services are actually testing, treating and helping everybody, including refugees and asylum seekers. Finally, in terms of the key priorities and strategies that we have put in place, we are very much still with you in all the country operations where we work, still ramping up our preparedness efforts. And this is done in close coordination with the state authorities, but also the refugees, host communities, and all of you. There are still risk mitigation measures that can be taken at this point in time, especially in areas where refugees live in more remote locations, and emergency response and business continuity should continue. Of course, you will be talking a bit more during the webinar about the importance of refugees being empowered with information that is accessible to them, that is accurate, that is verified, and that is translated into their language. This is really one of the big problems in many areas, is making sure that the information is not only accessible, but it's accessible in a language that is understood, so that these individuals and committees can take decisions about their own protection themselves. And also, risk communication and community engagement is critical, that it will hold us also accountable to the services we provide. I cannot overemphasize here the importance that refugees and asylum seekers have in their own protection. And it is important that in our activities today, a lot of it is also about reminding all the community volunteers and leaders, and more generally, the persons we interact with, the importance of self-protection so that they can continue to work safely with other members of the community. We need to adapt our operational response. UNHCR has started to do that. As I said, many of us are now working remotely. This is not only us here in Geneva, but also in many locations in the world. And so as we have been relying and actually expanding on methodologies that we had already of communicating with refugees through mobile phones, call centers, hotlines, you know, but we've in some places opened new internet platforms and of course made bigger use of social media. And this is important because that allows us two-way communication. We have also extended and expanding our community-based protection activities. We rely, of course, greatly on existing networks and community interventions, both within refugees and host communities. But we also rely very much on all our local partners and hope to continue working closely with them. I wanted also to talk a little bit about the importance that cash-based interventions have had and will have in the future. We need to expand these programs so that we can compensate as much as we can families' loss of income in the refugee and host communities. This requires joint efforts, the international community, donors, but also many other stakeholders need to support inclusion of refugees in national response. In many situations, the host countries are willing, but are not able to provide the services they would like to provide to refugees. We all have a role to play in supporting them. And finally, talking to my earlier point on the long-term impact of COVID, we need to all advocate and try to see how refugees can already, if they are not included, be part of social protection, safety nets, and others. I thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Bernadette. And really, really interesting observations and comments. I had in mind two to highlight. Just one, the one that you mentioned, the longer term issue. I mean, some of the predictions are suggesting that the economic downturn is going to be significantly heavier than the one in 2008, and it's going to affect lower and middle income countries much more than the 2008 economic downturn did. It's a very good observation to think about that. The other one that I wanted to highlight, which I was glad you mentioned, is this idea that some of the containment measures seem to be only looking at the epidemiology and the health aspect and sometimes the economy, not necessarily considering some of the rights and protection issues. And it's almost a false dichotomy to say it's one or the other. So I was glad that you highlighted that they can actually exist next to each other. Of course, you may have to be flexible on some areas, but overall the society and the community will be better off. So just a quick background, as the Alliance, as the child protection community, and many of you were involved in that, in 2014 and 15, found ourselves in a situation where the Ebola crisis caught us off guard, and we were not able to, at least in the first few months, do a very good job in responding to protection needs. We came together as a community and tried to figure out what can we do that we're not necessarily used to doing. A series of really interesting programs and interventions were put together. Out of that came a guidance note that the Alliance produced in 2018, which was based on the Ebola, lessons from MERS and SARS and cholera outbreaks and Zika. And then when COVID-19 hit, we, even though we had the guidance note, which we still believe is a very comprehensive and strong document, we felt that there is need for a very short, succinct, to-the-point document that talks to or speaks to the issue of COVID-19 and the issues that are coming around child protection. It's both heartening and disappointing to see that child protection is highlighted a bit more in this crisis. I think we're doing a better job at making sure that child protection and protection issues in general are a bit more considered than, for example, they were in the first few months of Ebola. But we have a long way to go. So that's the disappointing part. So hopefully, together with all of you guys, we can put it higher on the agenda. So the technical note, and maybe the next one, just very quickly, most of you hopefully will be familiar with this. You can go to the Alliance website and find the technical note. It's already translated into 11 languages, 10 or 11 languages, I believe, that are finalized. And there's 5 more that are in the making. If you are working in a country where we don't have the language, please feel free to reach out to us, and Sarah can kindly put the generic email address in the chat box so you can contact us to help us. Actually, out of these, I think 15 translations, we only translated 4 of those, and the 11 of them were done by people like you who were working in a field location and helped with translation. So we structured the technical notes in 2 broad sections. One is focusing on child protection risks, starts by looking at the socio-ecological model and talking about how at each level of the socio-ecological model, from child to family to community to society, COVID-19 containment measures are disrupting the environment where children can protect it and thrive and be well. Then on the next part, we talk about specific risks. I'm not going to go into the details of this. You can all look at the technical note. And the second part of the technical notes specifically, so when the first part we talk about what is the problem, or what are the problems that can come up because of the COVID-19 containment measures, and the second part talks about what we can do. And there's a very strong focus on working with other sectors and with governments who are mostly in charge of containment measures and other plans that are being put in place to control this. And the 2.2, which is the second part under part two, focuses on what child protection actors specifically can do. Now, just flagging that this is not a comprehensive guidance. It's short. We want it to be to the point. So there are, because of that, there are some specific annexes being developed that are looking at some of the technical areas. There are three that are coming up soon. I think by next week, we should have at least two of them. By the following week, all three of them. One focuses on alternative care and the issue of separation. One focuses on protection of social service workforce. So people like yourself who are working in responding to protection needs, whether in refugee settings or not. And then children deprived of their liberties is another one. And then there are multiple that are under consideration. Again, I won't go into detail, but hopefully on our next webinar, we can report on that. I now want to turn to Amanda Melville. Dr. Amanda Melville is currently working as a senior advisor for child protection and youth in UNHCR headquarters in Geneva. Dr. Melville has over 20 years of experience in international organizations, including UNHCR, UNICEF, Search for Common Grounds, and Save the Children. Her extensive experience includes technical support, policy, advocacy, strategy, planning, program design, and management in the field of child protection and psychosocial. Amanda has worked with UNHCR as a regional child protection specialist for the Middle East and North Africa, with UNICEF at global level in New York, at regional with Middle East region, as well as a number of country offices, including in South Africa, Indonesia, Palestine, Iran, and Haiti. Dr. Melville holds a Bachelor of Science with honors and PhD in conflict resolution from University of Melbourne. Amanda, over to you. Thanks for joining us.
It's quite impressive and a little bit intimidating to see so many colleagues in the field, and we're really humbled to have you with us here. We're very keen also to present this overview, but also going forward to hear from you about the excellent work that you're doing and some of the challenges and how we can support them. I just want to highlight a couple of key child protection risks that we've seen specifically for most impacting on refugee children. So the first one is it's important to understand that refugee children and their families are often less able to access the services and information than non-refugees because of a number of barriers, whether it's documentation, language, or socioeconomic issues, or perhaps even restrictions of movement. Secondly, the restrictions on movement can particularly lead to family separation, and it may be even more difficult for refugees or asylum seekers to be able to be reunified because they are not nationals of the country. Thirdly, the issues of disruption of daily routines, which impact on child well-being, as Bernadette said. I mean, many of the refugees and asylum seekers have already had a lot of disruption and uncertainty in their life. And so this is on top of that. And largely, you know, the additional issue of confinement at home and the increased risk of violence and abuse, particularly in contexts where many of the refugees living, where it may be already overcrowded and there already may be a lot of existing stresses on families and children that they are coping with prior to the COVID. Just a couple of key recommendations from our side, and we are really excited to have some of our colleagues from Plan, UNHCR and Save the Children who will be speaking to some of these concrete examples on how they've worked on it. Key recommendations to address family separation. One of the key ones that we've seen, it's very important to work with authorities to ensure that the movement restrictions allow for reunification of parents and families and help children remain together. So ensuring that where there are restrictions put in place, there are provisions for parents to move to be able to care for children. There are provisions for parents to be able to travel across border to be reunified with their families. These are very important and crucial advocacy messages for us to be working together with the authorities. Secondly, and we'll hear some examples of that, to provide family-based alternative care for children who have been separated or who are ill, or whose parents are ill. The other area that we've noticed is that many healthcare workers are also needing alternative care measures for their children because they themselves are not able to continue to travel and care for their children as well as actually work. This is an increasingly an issue that's coming up in some of the contexts here in Europe. So the example we'll be hearing about in that is, for instance, Plan International are working to expand the pool of caregivers to be on standby to provide alternative care for children. And UNHCR Ecuador will be speaking to us about some of the work they've been doing on alternative care. So one of the things we hear the most about is how do we adapt and ensure continuity of services, particularly for the most crucial child protection services. We'll be hearing some examples of how we can try to put in place contingency plans to adapt services to maintain access to critical child protection services, either remotely or in person, including particularly case management and safe shelters. It's very important that in our advocacy with the authorities, but also with the senior management, that we are clear on the point that some of these child protection services are life-saving and must continue. Secondly, we've heard a lot about the establishment and scale-up of helplines, online assistance, ensuring that children perhaps can have access to online assistance if they're confined at home and don't have the level of confidentiality to have phone calls, and ensuring that hotline staff, if they're hotlines are particularly trained in child protection. And we'll be hearing a little bit about the identification and referral from health services from, I think, our colleagues in UNHCR in Ecuador. The other area that we just want to make sure is that where in-person services are required, it's important that we think and plan about ensuring that staff know the risk mitigation measures that they need to take and wherever possible have access to protective equipment to allow them to continue those in-person crucial child protection areas. We have an example. We'll be doing a specific webinar on this, but there's in Lebanon, the child protection subsector has produced guidance on adapting case management and putting in place strict protocols around home visits. All cases are dealt with by phone except high-risk cases, where visits are conducted in areas where there are confirmed COVID cases only after the family has been cleared by a health actor. So we have a very good example of how the Lebanon child protection subsector have adapted their case management services. And we'll be hearing from our colleagues later in that in terms of the specifics of a number of ways they've all adapted. The other area, obviously, is the impact on education. We've heard a lot about how to ensure innovative ways to access education, but we have to remember that for many refugee children and families, there are logistical and financial challenges to online learning. So it's important that we consider those practical issues if learning is going to move to remote learning, that we are able to support refugee children and asylum seeking children with the logistics and other children, host community children who may not have access to online services in terms of access to education. And obviously to provide schools with information to help them prepare for and support remote learning and resources to inform children and staff of how to protect themselves. And we'll be hearing a bit more about that. There's some great resources online if you're not familiar with that, specifically for education settings. So for instance, in Jordan, in the refugee camps, the electricity supply has been extended to allow children to study through the Ministry of Education remote learning at allocated times. The other area we've been talking about is community-based child protection. So how do we adapt our recreational opportunities and community engagement? It's very important to recognize that there will be different levels of restriction and guidance in terms of what is possible. It's important that wherever we're doing recreational activities, we can adapt them according to national guidelines and make sure that all our staff and volunteers are properly trained on how to follow and adapt the recreational activities when face-to-face activities are still possible. The next one I just wanted to highlight is also there will be a lot of settings, and we are currently seeing a lot of settings where face-to-face activities are not possible. So looking at alternative methods for adolescents and young people to contribute. So for example, UNHCR is working with refugee young people to adapt videos illustrating key messages in different settings and languages. I'm sure many of you already have great examples of how to support more online activism and engagement through social media with adolescents. One of the key things that we've seen, and Bernadette mentioned it, is the importance of accessing accurate information. And we know that there are two issues when it comes to refugees and asylum seekers. The first one is that it's important that the existing information is disseminated, accurate information is disseminated and accessible to refugees in languages they understand, through networks they understand. And secondly, we need to be thinking about how we adapt to the existing guidance to the reality of living in overcrowded settings and with settings with limited access to WASH facilities. How practically can we adapt guidance from social distancing and hygiene to contexts where it can be very difficult? So we'd be very keen to be hearing from you if any of you have had those kind of examples of how to do that. A couple of examples of that. So in Lebanon, UNHCR manages a refugee managed Facebook user with hundreds of thousands of users, and it flags rumors to UNHCR and raises awareness of COVID fake news in Arabic and sends out accurate, correct information, reliable information. And in Lebanon, they've also, UNHCR has also established a communication tree through WhatsApp, which reaches 100,000 families. Italy, in UNHCR Italy, they've established an online portal where persons of concern can access information in 15 different languages on health advisory, regulation, movement restrictions, and services available. So these are just some of the concrete examples of how we can, you know, reach out specifically to refugees and ensure that they're able to access information that are needed. I won't be talking specifically about child-friendly information and parenting information because my colleague Pieter will be speaking to that. So this is a broad introduction. We're really keen now to hear from our field colleagues. So I'll hand back to Hani. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much.
My name is Lovely WCA. I'm the Child Protection and Emergency Advisor. I'm working with Save the Children in Nigeria. I'm just going to talk a little bit about how we've been able to modify our program, particularly around case management as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic. Just to give you a background of what we are doing here in Nigeria, we are responding to the refugee crisis. Our refugees that are coming from Cameroon, from the English-speaking part of Cameroon into Nigeria, working in that location since 2015, responding to the needs of refugee children and families. So straight into our presentation, we're told to give a background of how we've been able to modify and what methods we are using in terms of reaching families and at the same time adhering to the public health protocols that are in place by the Nigerian government. We've been able to sensitize all of our caseworkers. Our caseworkers are community-based hired caseworkers on prevention measures around COVID. And in addition to that, we've been able to give them hand sanitizers and some hygiene materials that will be able to protect them while they continue to provide services to vulnerable children. And the information is not only for caseworkers, but we are working with gatekeepers as well to ensure that we all follow the public health regulations and maintain social distancing as we do our work. And also aware that it's also a difficult time for Liberia. I work with Save the Children, and we know how kind of pandemic can be so difficult for staff. So we've been able to support our staff, giving them materials and support in terms of self-care, because everyone is worried right now, worried in terms of whether or not you're going to be infected or some of your own family members are going to be infected. And even for the families that we work with, staffs have been concerned. So we are giving them information around self-care and how they can be able to also work with families within the communities, especially vulnerable families. And right now in Nigeria, we have three states where we have policy placed by the government where everyone is supposed to remain home. We are in self-isolation or self-quarantine. Treatment has been restricted for a lot of families now. So in terms of monitoring and supporting and continuously supervising our caseworkers, we are using the phone to be able to do this, especially for the locations we work in. There are some areas where we have, so we do pre-recording messages, and then caseworkers can get to a location where they can be able to access signal, and then they can get the information that has been recorded by our child protection officers. So that is something that we've been able to do to be able to reach them in terms of providing them the services. We've been observing quite recently that a number of cases that has been coming up since COVID-19. So we have decided to allocate emergency case management funds, especially where the referral pathway has been exhausted and there are no service providers. We have emergency funds that can be able to go ensure that families can reach the health facility or they can access services in the different locations that we work in. So we've been able to put into place a mechanism where we have emergency case management funds that are easily accessible to the team on the ground. How we've been able to prioritize the different cases based on the follow-ups we've been making with our caregivers, particularly for unaccompanied and separated children. We've been able to intensify the follow-ups because families are concerned about the restriction. They are poor families. They have to go out to be able to fetch food in some settlements. So they're being concerned about what impact the restriction on families. So we've intensified our follow-ups even to families with our unaccompanied or separated children that did not have pre-existing protection concerns. And then in terms of our supervision, we continue to provide prepaid cards for our caseworkers where when they have issues in the community, they can quickly use GSM phones to be able to contact us, and then we can be able to provide them the necessary services. And then we need to be referred because of the restriction on movement and the social distancing. We are utilizing our phones to get in contact with other service providers. With support from UNHCR, we've been able to update the referral pathway to include other service providers that are responding to COVID. So we have an updated referral pathway and it's being continuously updated, and we have shared that with our caseworkers and the gatekeepers as well in the community. And we try to make sure that we do follow-up emails to the organizations that are responsible or providing the specific specialized service or whatever service the child needs at the time. And then most importantly, I think we have some cross-thematic themes that we've been focusing on, especially around gender. We've been trying to document how it's affecting both boys and girls, and not forgetting our child safeguarding and PSEA policy. We continue to work with our communities. We continue to call them on phones and provide information to them on our CSG policy and assuring them of our accountability platform that we have. When there are issues in the community, they can be able to report to us directly. So that's what we've been able to do, Nigeria, in terms of responding to the COVID-19.
Thank you very much, Lovely. This was a really interesting view from the field. Thanks for your experience. I'll quickly turn to Marion.
So thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Marion Mwebi from Plan International Tanzania, working in Kigoma region where we have 3 refugee camps. So currently, presentation I'm going to do is under the scenario that we currently don't have a lockdown, but in Tanzania we have at least 20 confirmed cases, but no case within the refugee context. So I want to quickly highlight some of the adaptations that we have done within the refugee context. So the first one I'll talk about is about case management adaptation. So what we have done so far as Plan International, we have been able to cut down on the number of home visits that we are conducting to children undergoing case management. And with this, we're using a prioritization criteria. We realize that the interagency criteria will have to be adapted. So we have adapted to be able to focus on prevention of family separation in light of the COVID pandemic, but also looking at high-risk unaccompanied and separated children who are in need of alternative care. We are also focusing on follow-up for children in protection villages, basically the children with heightened protection risks, and also support for child survivors of SGBV. And then also for the high-risk cases, we are also supporting vulnerable children in need of of BIP, best interest procedures, and this is connected to the voluntary repatriation of Burundian refugees. Some of the key light of supporting media working with, we have adapted and working with our trained incentive workers and the trained community structures to be able to support us with the follow-up of the medium to low risk cases because of the limitation or and maintaining the physical distancing, but also scaling down. Just for information, for the other intervention, for example, community-based activities, psychosocial support have been temporarily put on hold. So we are currently in our context continuing with the case management component. The other thing that we have done, adapted in relations to case management, is maintaining the physical distancing, especially when interviewing vulnerable children and families, and of course, integrating with the hygiene practices. Another thing that we have done in relation to the case management is centralization in terms of where we are conducting interviews. So initially we used to have decentralized interventions using the satellite offices, but currently we are only able to focus on interviews of the high-risk cases I've just mentioned above. We are currently doing it with, through the field offices within the refugee camps. So the other adaptation that we have done is in relation to children in need of alternative care. Of course, this is an ongoing program, but in light of the COVID, there are a few changes that also we have adapted to. For example, we were working with our foster parents, but we realized the need to have standby foster parents. So we have mobilized and continue mobilizing more standby foster parents to be able to support us, for example, for children, orphans and vulnerable children, who initially were not children considered to be in need of alternative care, but in the event there is death related to COVID, orphans and vulnerable children will be able to get the alternative care. This is one of the scenarios where looking in, if the situation deteriorates, then we are likely to have, for example, child-headed households, children left within households, and this is one of the scenarios that we are working with to ensure that such children are immediately linked and supported through the standby foster parents. The other thing that we have done is we are doing as Plan International is to be able to provide psychoeducation sessions and orientation. So initially we were doing this through trainings, structured trainings and capacity building, but in light with the physical distancing, this one we are able now to do through phone calls, but also through one-to-one because of the risk associated of bringing several people together. And with this also, for basic key trainings, for example, child safeguarding and care, now we have limited the number of participants. Instead of, for example, 30 participants, now we are working with a group of 10 to 15 at maximum to just ensure that we are adhering to the physical distancing and the government directive related to COVID. The other thing that we have done in our context, in collaboration with the other partners, for example, UNHCR, UNICEF, together with other child protection partners, just like the other speakers who talked before me, we are working at interagency level and we have developed operational continuity plan within the refugee context, looking at different scenarios. So currently we are able to provide services, but in light if the situation deteriorates, currently strengthening WASH and health components, working alongside them to ensure the health and WASH partners specifically have greater understanding on child protection risk related to COVID and basic support that they can be able to offer to support vulnerable children. So with this, also we foresee some of the challenges this pandemic is likely to pose. For example, challenges related to fully implementing interagency standards, whereby all children undergoing case management receives at least a visit once in a month. And here we are adapting to focusing on high-risk children and now leaving the medium and low-risk cases, of which now we are supporting through the trained community workers and community structures. So this is one of the challenges that we really foresee. It's not only in this operation, but just like many other operations within the refugee camps. So the other challenge that we foresee is an increase of number of orphans and vulnerable children who will also need case management, which is one of the case laws that we have not been focusing. So the last one is related to provision of psychosocial support for children who will be in isolation centers, which also forces a key challenge. So one of the adaptations that are moving forward in the last scenario we are adapting now is use of a toll-free number where we can be able to provide remote case management. And I will pause there so that we can be able to manage on time. Otherwise, thank you very much.
Great. Hello, everyone.
Sofia, if you can introduce yourself first and then go into your presentation, please. Thank you for joining.
Okay, so I'm Sofia Baccichetto. I work as a senior child protection assistant in UNHCR Ecuador for about 5 years now. And I'm going to talk a little bit about case management of unaccompanied and separated children in Ecuador. Since the Venezuela situation started here in the South American continent mostly, we have seen an interesting increase in the identification of unaccompanied and separated children, mostly adolescents over 14 years old. So from about 200 cases in 2018, we have been identifying more than 350 cases just in 2020. So we have identified the need to start some alternative care measures as a protection response and give support to the government in this aspect. So we have some child protection specialized partners that have been implementing supervised independent living arrangements for these adolescents mostly. And we have been also providing technical support to the government to develop the legal framework for these alternative care arrangements in Ecuador. Basically, the process worked that any organization or actor in the humanitarian sector could identify the unaccompanied and separated children. They will make a reference to the authorities for the assessment, and themselves will make a reference to the local authorities to give the protection measures itself. And the child protection partners will provide the alternative care measures. So this specialized independent living arrangement involves psychological support, constant assessment of the case and family tracing efforts, regular home visits, multipurpose CVI that includes housing, food, hygiene products, health, also educational and training for professional abilities, and supervised integration to working environments, in order to start giving some independence to the adolescents that don't have any other opportunities or family reunification or any other protection measures available. In the COVID-19 emergency, we have worked with partners to make sure services remain available in accordance to health guidelines and adjusted to the current context. We are working to respond to two different possible situations. New cases of unaccompanied and separated children identified, mostly on borders and cities, and children and adolescents in risk of being separated from their caregivers because they become ill and need to be hospitalized. We, in lack of local authorities that can give an effective response because we are on lockdown right now. The government has told us to be in lockdown, so there are some authorities that are working remotely, and it's very difficult for them to access our demands and everything. So UNHCR and its partners are committed to respond to these cases with a family placement when it's available and a supervised independent living arrangements or other emergency measures. But I just wanted to wrap up saying that we have adapted our services to do more remote psychological support and case management and follow-up. We still give multi-purpose CBI, and we have been able to extend it so that it can respond to the needs of the population. And there is no personal and physical contact that is established with new cases unless it is imperative in cases with high risks, such as medical risks or safety risks whatsoever. So we have
multifunctional teams that do this follow-up to the programs and make sure that these are working and that the adaptments that have been done are working for the population as well. These multifunctional teams also include shelter teams, protection teams, and program colleagues that have been able to adjust also the PPAs of our partners to respond to the emerging needs, expanding the length of support of the CBI and the different support provided to respond to the food security and hygiene needs, as well as we have also been providing dignity kits to the population. Our main concern right now is the access to territory and asylum systems, because the front lines have been closed by the authorities. But we are working with the national immigration authorities in order to advocate for vulnerable populations to be admitted in the Ecuadorian territory, trying to build protocol to include these populations and let them access territory and access the asylum system. This will obviously include unaccompanied and separated children.
Pieter Vetevogel is the Senior Mental Health Officer with UNHCR in Geneva in the Public Health Section. He has been trained as a psychiatrist and a medical anthropologist and works in humanitarian settings for over 18 years.
Yes, okay, thank you very much, Hani. My name is Pieter. You can just say Pieter, actually. That's how I do it myself. I work with UNHCR. I sit in the Public Health Section, and one of the problems in the way we organize humanitarian work is that sometimes the people who work in program, in health, or in other technical units have limited contact with protection people, and that's not good. So I'm happy that I'm here to talk a little bit about public health. That will be my first few slides, and then about mental health and psychosocial support. It will be brief because I can give you a lot of technical details, but you will probably forget them, and I may not even be able to transmit them very well, because I am a doctor, but I'm actually specialized in psychiatry. So many of the things that my colleagues in the public health section talk about are also not my specialty. This is a little bit of a difficult slide, but it's to show you the way of thinking within public health. What you see here is a pyramid of representing all the people who are infected with COVID, who have COVID. And what you see a lot in the media, also the reported cases in many of the newspapers, are about the top layers of the pyramid, people who have the more severe forms of COVID, so severe that they actually need treatment and they are admitted in a hospital or otherwise get medical treatment. There are many more people who have COVID but have little or even no symptoms. And that is important for the way we try to contain the epidemic. It's also important when we look at resource poor settings, particularly the settings where we talk about in sub-Saharan Africa and in Asia and the Middle East, is that a lot of the pictures that we see in the media about people in intensive care units is probably not what we will be able to deliver in refugee camps if the epidemic breaks out there. But there is a lot that we can do, and that is particularly related to people who have severe forms of COVID but do not require intensive care, because there is a lot of improvement in the public health facilities that can be done. And that is the work of my colleagues, is actually to improve the healthcare facilities in refugee settings to ensure that people with more severe forms of COVID can be helped. So that is one part. The second thing is that it's important that those people with non-symptomatic or mildly symptomatic forms of COVID are not contributing to a further spread of the disease. So this is this famous flattening of the curve. And that is important. And that is perhaps the most important public health measure that we have. We are all in it. We are all isolated at home now. We have movement restrictions, etc. And this is important also when we look at children. Even though sometimes you hear people saying that, well, children are hardly affected by COVID. Because you hear it's mainly affecting older people above 70 and 80. Well, that's not fully true. Adults and children are equally likely, as far as we know, to become infected with COVID. What is true is that children much less likely will get severe symptoms. And that's what we don't know, whether children have, even if they are mildly affected, have a role in transmitting the virus. Most likely they have, which means that actually all the public health measures that we talk about are equally valid for children. A little bit about the symptoms. I think you've all heard about fever and cough and sore throat, but it is important that in children, as in many other illnesses, it can manifest slightly different, including, for example, gastrointestinal symptoms. So symptoms in the belly and the stomach, which could be part of a COVID infection. One aspect of the epidemic is also what we call the infodemic. You will all have noticed that it's really difficult to get the right information. And particularly when it comes to health information, it's extremely important to have access to the correct medical information. So my advice would be very simple, to go to the World Health Organization website. If you go to who.int and then you see the slide that you see on the right, the screenshot, you can go to advice for the public that actually has very nice materials and that are translated in many languages, and that actually you can be sure that it is also valid in the context where you work. Still, in every country where UNHCR works, we follow obviously the guidelines of the national ministry. Now, for those who work in an organization where there is also a health unit, please use that person as the central person in the medical aspects of the COVID response. Most of the UNHCR offices have a public health officer or a public health focal point, and these people are in daily contact with the regional public health officers and with the public health unit in UNHCR. For those who work with UNHCR, there is an intranet page specifically for COVID, and you can see that that's the second slide, the second screenshot on the right, and there is a specific page on public health and WASH, as well as on communication with communities, as well as also mental health and psychosocial support. Lastly, UNHCR Public Health Unit will launch a dashboard for public health, more or less similar to the protection dashboard that I think is already operational. There will be also one for public health. It will be launched today or tomorrow, and that is accessible for everyone. It's probably more interesting for medical staff, but it also contains good information for non-health staff. It focuses particularly on, let's say, the level of threat that COVID causes in a specific setting where there are significant numbers of refugees. So this is to be found also through the intranet. Now, this wasn't the first part of my presentation, and I will be happy to answer questions later around the health aspect. The key document, because Amanda and Hani asked me, try to keep it simple and tell people what is the core information that they need to have. Where should they go? Now, for mental health and psychosocial support, beyond any doubt, this is the one. It's an interagency guidance from the IESC reference group for mental health and psychosocial support. It's been very active. It's translated in, I think, slightly less languages than the child protection note that Hani talked about, but still it's between 10 and 20 languages at the moment. You can find that on the IESC website and also on the internet page of UNHCR that I talked about. Now, this guidance was made in the beginning of the emergency, so about 6 weeks ago. So we are currently working on annexes on specific topics. And one of the topics that will be added is a specific guidance on dealing with loss, grief, and anxiety in teenagers, because we find that there is very limited information on that group. The next topic is communication with communities. And again, there I would go to the WHO site. This is this one pager that actually is very helpful, translated in many languages, that I could really advise you to go to. Third one is about parenting. And here the key resource to go to is this one. It's an interagency document which has six simple one-page tips for parents how to deal with their children in stressful times. These, the messages that I now gave, were all about helping adults explaining things to children, but they were not targeting children directly. There are some materials, but not that many. You can find a few on the community of practice of UNHCR on child protection and the AOR. But there is one thing, and that will be my last topic, that is just new, a publication from the IES, an illustrated book for children 5 to 11 years old, which I think is fantastic. It has been made with the help of 1,700 children worldwide and parents who have filled in questionnaires and who have been in contact. It's about a girl. This is Sarah. You can see her. Her mother is a medical staff, and she gets very frightened about COVID, and she doesn't know what to do. She's in her bed, she can't sleep, and then she sees another animal that comes and helps her, and then she's going to travel. And during her travel, she comes to all kinds of different locations, people from different countries, different cultures, and she interacts with them. And during that interaction, she learns a lot about how she can protect herself and her dear ones from COVID. It contains very practical exercises, for example, breathing exercises, as you can see here, but also practical information, as you all know, the hand washing, coughing in your elbow, etc. The book will be translated in very many languages. If you are interested in translating it in your own language, the language where you work, contact War Child Holland, Maya, who is coordinating the distribution of the language and the translation. There will be audio messages as well. So I think this is a great tool for parents and other people working with children to actually engage children in their own words and in their own ways in the discussion on COVID.